St. Junia United Methodist Church. St. Junia is a new church in Birmingham, Alabama, and we meet on Sundays at 4:30 p.m. at Sidebar Cafe on 7th Avenue. We'd love for you to join us sometime. Our vision is to become a diverse community of sinners, saints, and skeptics who join God in the renewal of all things. We think sinners, saints, and skeptics describes just about everybody. So whoever you are, whatever your background, we'd love to have you join us. Thanks. I hope you enjoyed today's worship service. Hi, folks.
So this is our sound check. We're starting with a sound check. Am I on back there? I'm on. Testing. Check, 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 check. Testing, testing, testing. Testing, testing. Check, check, check. Testing, 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 testing. Testing, testing. Oh, testing, testing. Testing, 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 testing. I'm sorry. I'm on. Oh, what channel? Is that what you're asking? Check, 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 check. Testing, testing, testing. Testing, testing, testing. Test, test. Did you ask what channel I'm on? It's not reading it. It occurred to me, also, I just realized that we don't have a microphone set up there for the readers. It just says 3H. Okay. Yeah. So, test, test. I see my test. I'm right there. Boom, boom, boom. But testing, 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 testing. Testing, testing, testing. Test, test, test. Testing, testing. Check, check, check. Okay. Testing, 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 testing. Testing, 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 testing. Nada. Okay. Check, 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 check. Yeah, but just not sure why it's not coming out. Well, we don't have a mic set up for the reader either, so we may just have to project.
Okay.
So hey, buddy.
All right, I'll keep playing with it.
So okay. All right. Yes, sir. Okay. Okay. could you go back and help out for a minute? They're trying to pinpoint some issues.
Is your mic not picking up?
Yeah. So we don't have a mic set up for the reader, so just project. Okay, we're not gonna stream that today. So, all right. Good afternoon. I'm going to project because apparently I'm not picking up right now. Welcome to St. Junia United Methodist Church. Welcome, sinners, saints, and skeptics. As I've said, we're sinners because we're all imperfect. We're saints because God is still at work making us perfect. We're skeptics because we all come with our own doubts and issues, and it's doubt that makes our faith real. God joins us here in worship so that we may join God in the renewal of all things. So before we begin today, may we pray together. God, who welcomes us all, you extend your love to us even when we feel unlovable and even when we feel we don't need your love. We come to you not because we are holy, but because you are, and not because we are faithful, but because you are. Draw near to us as we draw near to you, so that we may be shaped more fully in the image of Jesus. Amen.
Let's stand and sing. Me. sound great. Really good.
Basis that people wouldn't sing, and you proved me wrong, so thank you. Good job. One of the things that we do when we gather is that we share prayers. We share our celebrations, and we also share our concerns, and we lift up the concerns of the world. So before we do that, can I ask, are there any celebrations that we'd like to celebrate together? Tracy's not in here, but she ran the Mercedes Marathon. She deserves a hand for that. I told her if I had run the marathon, I wouldn't be here today. So, excellent. Susan did the half. Good job. 13 miles is a long way. That's why I can't imagine doing 26, because by the time I do 13, I'm done. Others? That's right. Ian got student of the month. Good job, Ian. Other prayers, celebrations. Duncan got the arrow of light on Thursday, right? Fantastic. Today is Kari's birthday. Happy birthday, Kari. Oh, Kari's over here. I'm sorry. I was looking back there for Kari. Others? All right. Well, the other thing we do is we also share our concerns and the concerns of the world. So what we'll do is I'll begin us in prayer, and then there will be a time for you. If you would like to lift up a name or a situation, we will all respond with, Lord, hear our prayer. So may we go to God in prayer. God, we lift up to you now all those who need you. And we lift up to you those who don't think they need you. And we lift up to you ourselves because we are both so often. Jesus, you said that those who hunger and thirst for righteousness would be filled. So we come to you hungry and thirsty, knowing that we can't get enough righteousness. Our world is a famine of justice, a drought of equity and liberation. So we thank you because you sustain us even in the midst of the desert with food enough for today, righteousness enough for today, justice enough for today. Give us hope that we will one day come to a land with an abundance of both justice and righteousness, where there's no more poverty, where everyone has access to health care, where all people have enough to eat, an adequate shelter and meaningful work, where the news channels are full of stories about peace breaking out between nations, and civil wars and terrorism have ended because there's no point to fighting anymore, because all the weapons of death and fear have been broken. Yet, God, you have already broken the power of death and fear when you courageously faced the injustice of the cross. So we pray for your healing and reconciling power in the lives of those we name before you, and I invite you to share at this time. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, hear our prayer. For the family of the student in Trustville who took his own life, Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, hear our prayer. God, anywhere there is pain, anywhere there is suffering, anywhere where justice and love have yet to be realized, wherever there's sickness, we know that your presence brings healing and all things good. We ask for your presence in the lives of those people we've named, in those situations in the world where people need some good news. Help us also to be agents of your gospel, your good news, so that people may have hope and we may all come to the love and knowledge of your Son, Jesus Christ. And we pray the prayer he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And so for thousands of years after Christians would pray and they would receive that peace of Jesus Christ, they would pass it to other people. They would practice what they were going to do out in the world, which is to pass peace. And so you can do that the formal way by saying, peace of Christ be with you, and the response is also with you. Or if you do want to do that the informal way and say, hey, how's it going? You can do that as well. Would you stand and pass the peace? People who like to pass peace. That's good. That's a good thing. Welcome. So glad that all of you are here today. This is this is the first Sunday of Lent. Lent is the 40 days preceding Easter, not including Sundays. It started on Ash Wednesday, this past Wednesday, and it's sort of this time of preparation for Easter, which is going to be here before we realize it. It's on April the 5th, I think. So usually, and in churches, we often will gear our sermons and that sort of thing toward preparation for Easter. I'm not doing that. In fact, we are going to be preparing for Easter, but we're going to be taking a little different approach. After we wrap up the relationship series next week, we're going to spend 5 Sundays really looking at the DNA of our church, about what our goals are, our mission is. What we have done, where we've been, where we're going. And my goal is that then by Easter we celebrate what Christ is doing among us, because that's what Easter is really about. And then the Sundays following Easter, I want us to really take some time to look at some specific ways that I think God is challenging us to grow in the future. We're going to do some, I'm going to have some guests come in to talk about we're going to have a training called LGBT 101, which is learning a little bit about lingo and justice issues for lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender persons. And I'm going to have another guest speaker come in to talk about racial justice. And the goal here is really to help us stretch in our discipleship. One of the wonderful things about being a pastor for y'all and having started a new church is that I get to get up here and really cut loose and let my hair down and tell you what I think. And I love it because most of you agree with me. That's not always the case in a lot of churches. But the challenge for me as a pastor then is, how do I help you grow as a disciple? I mean, our goal is not simply to be together and say, oh, yes, it's nice to be right. The goal is to grow in our love of God and neighbor, to grow in our discipleship, and to stretch ourselves. And I think in a lot of ways, we are uniquely positioned to do some things in Birmingham that few other churches can do. Even though we are not a mega church with a multi-million dollar budget, we have already had more impact, I think, on churches in Birmingham, on people in Birmingham, than a lot of other churches that are five, six times our size. So I think we're doing wonderful things. But I really would like to spend the next several weeks looking at where I think God is calling us to go next. I look forward to doing that journey with you. But we are going to continue to do scriptures that fit with the season, with the 40 days of Lent. Today we have a celebration in that we're going to be welcoming another member of our church. I'd like to invite Travis Ford to read our gospel lesson.
Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.
Thank you. Wonderful season of the Christian calendar. I think it's full of it's easy to mess it up, and one of the ways in which I think Lent gets messed up is if we experience it as an exercise in deprivation. It's like we should give up something for Lent, as if in God's family scarcity is a value, and a lot of us have already lived lives scarcity, where there's not enough, you can't get enough, whatever it is, enough love, enough cocaine, enough whatever, life is about, already about not enough, and here this Christian community says, well, let's practice more, not enough, and I think that's profoundly counterproductive. I've learned a lot about Lent from my wife, who one year decided for Lent. We, over a course of years, decided to take Lent more seriously. And one year, she decided to give up shame for Lent. And the notion is, why not give up something that's really killing us?
You may be all you get is just sort of see.
Reminded of the fact that we're in Lent, even though I'm actually not preaching on Lent, we are in the season of preparation, of getting ready for Easter. And for me, as I've shared about this series on relationships, for me, this is part of preparation. Because I think Christians, Jesus spends the entire Sermon on the Mount talking about how we should live our lives differently. What the difference is that this good news should make in our lives. And so I believe part of Lent is getting ready to live out that good news. Oftentimes, I think we don't recognize that Jesus' resurrection applies to everything, including our relationships, including the ways that we live our lives, as we just heard, living lives not of scarcity but of abundance. So we've been doing this series called Better Together. This is actually our penultimate, that means second to last. This is our penultimate sermon. And today we're talking about trust. Now sometimes I imagine what kind of conversation Judas would have had with people about his betrayal of Jesus. I think we have a picture of one of the famous scenes. Judas comes to greet Jesus and he betrays him with a kiss. Right? He betrays him with this sign of trust. Now, I imagine as that discussion went on, as he was planning to do that, he went to the temple priests and he said he had seen the bounty posters up around the city. They had wanted posters with Jesus' face on them. Not really, but just imagine for a minute that it said wanted with a picture of Jesus underneath it. And Judas goes in and he negotiates with the temple police, who are like the marshals, about how to bring Jesus into the temple to trial. And one of them says, so why have you decided to betray your friend? And I imagine Judas saying something like, betrayal is such an ugly word. I prefer the term strategic realignment. You know? Because it really is, it is, when we talk about betrayal or breaking trust, oftentimes we don't realize that's exactly what's happening. I'm not even sure Judas realized what was happening. Of course, we can debate. There's a lot of speculation about what was going on there. But I think it's fascinating that one of the major themes of the gospel is trust. Trust is a huge part of the gospel. Jesus preaches about trusting God. He tells his followers, don't hoard up earthly treasures, store up heavenly ones. Trust that God will provide for you. He talks about making yourself vulnerable. Loving enemies. He exhorts people to trust God and to trust each other. And, well, honestly, look where it gets him. Nailed to a cross. But I still think that there's something about the gospel that invites us to practice that sort of risky trust. As I said, we've been talking about relationships during this series. We've talked a little bit about I've been using the example of Gottman. We've talked about emotional intelligence, talked about the seven principles of making marriage work, and I've been emphasizing that all of these things, when we talk about relationships, they're applicable to all relationships, not just marriage, but also friendships, working relationships, family relationships, siblings, all this kind of stuff. Now, we use this word trust frequently as a verb. Do you trust me? Or I don't trust him. But trust is really a lousy verb. It is a lousy verb. I never really, it's probably about as vague as the word faith. We talk about having faith. And then I think that the obvious follow-up to that is, what do you mean by that? What do you mean by faith? What do you mean by trust? I never really stopped to think about the fact that trust isn't just one thing until I read John Gottman breaks it down. Now, the book I'm talking about, this is his book for popular consumption called The Science of Trust. He's got another book on trust where he really talks about game theory, and which, if you're a nerd, you probably know something about game theory, which is a fascinating area of study. It involves statistics and psychology and philosophy and a lot of other things. But he really looks at what we're doing when we talk about trusting somebody. Again, I've talked a lot about Gottman during this series, the way he can sit a couple down on a sofa and ask them to talk about an issue in their lives and within 10 minutes tell you with 90% accuracy whether they're going to stay together or get a divorce. And that's remarkable stuff. We've talked about the magic 8-to-1 ratio, 8 positive interactions to 1 negative one, the difference between criticism and complaints, the fact that people who complain more stay together longer, whereas criticism is not so much, the importance of emotional intelligence and that sort of thing. Well, the cool thing about this is the way that Gottman has applied game theory to talk about trust. Now, when most of us talk about trust, we really talk about this gut feeling. We talk about trusting your gut. And I've learned over time that most of the time when I trust my gut doesn't let me down. Have you ever met someone where you had that chemical reaction with, not positive one, but a negative one? Like, you encounter someone, and within split second, Malcolm Gladwell calls it thin slicing. Within, boom, instantly, you know this is not someone I trust. They set your teeth on edge. The hairs on the back of your neck go up. We talk about red flags going up. There are people I've sat across from in committee meetings and have barely exchanged more than 4 words with, but they make the hairs on the back of my neck stand up, and I hear the robot from Lost in Space going, "Danger, danger, Will Robinson." Right? And I try to be loving, because I want to be like Jesus, and I know all this stuff. Don't judge a book by its cover, and occasionally I've been wrong about folks, but I have to say that although I am occasionally wrong about folks, more often than not, I'm right. Have you had that experience? When my gut has been wrong, I've learned to trust my wife's gut, because her gut's even better than mine. So, you know, oftentimes when I'm with other people who I trust, I rely on their intuition. And the research on this stuff is actually pretty, it shows that there's stuff going on in our brains in a subconscious level that we're not even aware about. Our life experience begins to teach us characteristics of people who are trustworthy or not. Maybe it's something about their eyes or pheromones, I don't know what it is, but something tells us. We can't quite put our finger on what it is that bugs us, which, by the way, explains why parents and their teenage kids sometimes disagree about who their kids should be hanging out with. Parents do have better intuition than their kids because they have more life experience. Now, sometimes prejudice does play a role, but as I think back on my own teenage years, I have to say that most of the time my parents were right about who I needed to be careful around. Now, by the way, if you want to uncover some of your own prejudices, there's a great website. I think Harvard has it. It's called the Implicit Associations Test. And what this test does is it will either show you a picture of someone's face and then associate it with a negative or positive word, or it'll associate groups of people with positive or negative words. And it measures in milliseconds how long it takes you to distinguish between positive and negative words and positive and negative groups of people. And so it measures how prejudiced you are. And if you think you're not racist or xenophobic or whatever, you should do this implicit associations test, and it will reveal to you, even if you think you're an open-minded person, that yes, you are in fact prejudiced most of the time. It did for me. So I do think prejudice can play a role. So sometimes your gut can be wrong because you've learned these implicit associations. However, there is something to be said about your gut intuition. So how can we tease out what our gut is actually telling us? How can we name the traits that lead us to decide whether or not someone is trustworthy? G- Gottman identifies five different elements of trust. There's honesty, transparency, accountability, ethics, and what he calls alliance. Now, again, I think these are all important characteristics in a marriage. They're important characteristics among coworkers, among supervisors and subordinates and siblings and everything else. And I think in any organization, these characteristics are super important. Lots of corporate groups, by the way, maybe you've been part of one, will go do low ropes courses where you learn to trust your friends, and you know, you do the trust fall where you're blindfolded and you fall backwards and people are supposed to catch you. And of course, comedies like The Office poke fun at these things with good reason. Because, well, I mean, look, it's one thing for you to catch someone when there's other people watching you and there's social pressure for you not to drop somebody. It's quite another thing to refrain from running someone down behind their backs instead of complaining to them. Those are two very different behaviors. So learning to trust in one context and learning to trust in another, we really have to kind of see what's going on there. By the way, Dave Ramsey, who does Financial Peace University and does a lot of training about personal finance, he has a quick and easy definition of gossip. It's voicing criticism to someone who doesn't have the power to change it. So you could talk to somebody, in Gottman's terms, you would complain to somebody, mentioning a specific behavior to them that they could then change, or you could maybe complain to a supervisor who could then help them. But if you turn around and you complain to someone laterally or criticize someone laterally, that's gossip. If you do that in his organization, you get fired. Boom. I actually think that's pretty good. I wish more churches would actually implement that policy. Oh, we don't fire people. That's okay. Anyway, but this is actually a really important point. You know, we want to have that kind of relationship with other people. We want to have a culture of respect with other people that we don't have to walk on eggshells around folks. We can complain to them to change specific behavior, and where we're not criticizing people. In other words, impugning their character, saying nasty things about them. So let's look at each of these individually. Let's go to the next slide. We're going to kind of erase them, and then we're going to drop them down one at a time, I think. So the first one is honesty. So it means the person doesn't lie or practice deception. Now, naturally, if someone has lied to you about where they've been or what they've been doing or if they did something, you aren't going to trust them as much in the future. That's pretty obvious. And this is probably what most of us think about when we talk about honesty. I mean, talk about trust. We can trust what someone says. They tell the truth. I think it's also important to recognize that sometimes when people lie, they do so out of fear. They do so maybe because there's a culture of fear. Some people might lie for gain or to make themselves look better, and that, you know, we typically frown on that. But sometimes the culture of an organization leads people to be dishonest. If they're afraid of punishment or there's rampant dishonesty, it takes real courage and character to be honest when you're part of a toxic culture, if you're part of a lying culture or a lying relationship. But honesty is probably the most basic building block of trust. So don't lie. Don't be a person who lies. The other thing we could say about this is the person doesn't lead a second life. They're not one person with you and then another person elsewhere. Which brings us to the next one, which is transparency. Transparency means the person lives their life as an open book. They keep no secrets from you. You know the main people in their lives. You know their ambitions and stresses and their life dreams. When you request information about this person, they're forthcoming. They give it to you. If someone isn't transparent with you, that's a red flag. If you feel like someone's trying to hide some part of themselves from you, that's a red flag. The next one is accountability. Accountability means the person does what they say they will do. They will provide proof of it if asked. Oftentimes in marriages, my dad talks about providing, if there's a transaction, financial transaction, they have receipts. But transaction could mean a lot of other things. Transactions with others mean where you spent your time. So there's accountability. People follow through on their promises. Now, here's the thing. We all have times when we let other people down. Sometimes my life gets so busy I'll miss an appointment or something will happen like that. But accountability means we own that. We own up to our mistakes. We don't try to pass the buck on to somebody else because that's not being accountable. That means, yes, I screwed up. I will accept blame for that. That's accountability. So So it doesn't mean you don't make mistakes, but it means you own it when you do make a mistake. Ethics naturally means doing the right thing. We our ethical systems agree with another person's. We've witnessed that person having consistent and fair standards of conduct with other people. We agree with their values of right and wrong. And the last one is alliance. And this is actually a huge one when we're talking about marriage or partnership or working relationships. Alliance means that we feel the other person has got our back. The other person is on our side. The person is not forming coalitions with other people to bring us down. The person is concerned about our interests. They're concerned about what we want out of life. They're willing to help us accomplish that. Now, in marriage relationships, what often undercuts trust is if a spouse or a partner forms a coalition with a parent or an in-law against the other partner. Okay, this is actually a very common kind of scenario. Spouses need to feel that the other person has their back, is on their side. So, for example, when a husband's mother criticizes the wife, so you've got this in-law situation going, and her husband, instead of standing up for his wife, agrees with his mother-in-law, that's not having an alliance. Most gay relationships, the partners, when they do stand up for each other, but I've seen situations where if one partner is out and another partner is not out to their parents or their family, it becomes really difficult to stand up, and that criticism can really become toxic. So it's important that spouses, partners, have to be really clear with each other that whatever the world throws at us, I'm on your side. I've got your back. Now, I will share that actually one of my classic Dave screw-up, when Angela and I were on, I was a youth minister, and we were on a ski trip, I made a boneheaded decision, and I didn't have her back. I left her hanging, and she got very upset at me, justifiably. I got an F in that particular transaction. But it was because I did not have my wife's back. I didn't stand up for her to someone who was being a jerk. And I let her down. I think that's an important thing. In order to have a good, trusting relationship, you've got to believe that the other person will stand up for you, will defend you to other people who are trying to bring you down. So those are the five elements of trust. And now that you know them, maybe when your gut starts giving you those red flags, you can use this framework to ask, okay, so what is it exactly that I'm responding to? What is it that I'm receiving or feeling here that that I can put my finger on? And most of us can probably name a time when one or more of these principles was violated by a partner. Most of us can probably name a time that we've failed in one of these areas. As I said, there have been times I've gotten an F. But the thing is, what makes relationships resilient is this feeling that your partner has your back. Now, so what does actually trust do for us? What does this stuff do? Well, first, it creates resilience in relationships. So when there's stress in a relationship, financial stress, interpersonal stress, other kinds of stress, we can pull through it. Because even if we're frustrated in general, or we're frustrated with our partner, we trust them. Now, when I'm with high-caliber clergy colleagues, I can disagree strongly with them. And I have disagreed strongly with them over whether we're talking about gay marriage or Methodist politics or whatever social issues are going on, immigration. I can have a very strong disagreement with them, but I also believe that they have my back and they're my friends, and we can disagree and still have a relationship together. Now, if I feel like someone's trying to stab me in the back or get me kicked out of the church or whatever, then we don't have a good relationship. I do not trust that person. But it's amazing to have that kind of trusting relationship. Some of the best disagreements, conversations I've had with people are with people that I trust, and at the end of the disagreement, we can still be friends. That's huge. So it increases resilience. Also, it permits action with incomplete information. Gottman really goes to town on game theory here, but the short explanation is that sometimes we have to make decisions or we face crises without having all the data that we'd like to have. We have to make a decision without our partner being present, and that sort of thing. In those cases, we need to know that we can trust someone to follow through with their end of the bargain or their end of the situation. I want to be trustworthy to my spouse and other people, because sometimes you'll have a crisis, and I want to be able to say to you, don't worry about this area over here. I'll take care of it. You focus on what's important. And in a team, that is so important. I mean, that's why in competitive sports, you know, we have people who have different roles. And you want to be able to trust that this person is going to do their job, right? So that you don't have to worry about what's going on over here. Or if you can just sort of keep your eye on it. You don't have to be doing their job for them. To be able, in a situation, I can remember a time when one of our family members was in the hospital. And it was wonderful. It's such a good feeling to be able to say, look, you don't worry about this category over here. Don't worry about the pets. We'll take care of the pets. You do what you need to do, okay? That stuff is so important. So it permits action with incomplete information. We can carry on. We can do our business without worrying about the other stuff. Third, it reduces, this is Gottman's phrase, it reduces the complexity of all transactions. And what that means is interpersonal transactions, the discussions we have with each other. I'm not second-guessing you. I'm not worried about what you really think. I don't think that you're going to go do something different after we've had a conversation. It reduces all that complexity. Life is so much easier if I know my partner isn't going to shirk their responsibility and isn't going to try to cheat me or cheat on me. That's reducing the complexity. Now, Gottman goes on to talk about how we break trust, and he names 6 ways we break trust. This is not an exhaustive list, but here's some ways that we violate trust. We've violations of commitment or vows. This could be anything from adultery or to breaking contracts. Okay. Second, violations of exclusivity. And I like these phrasings here because it goes beyond adultery language or marriage language. There's lots of ways that couples can cheat that aren't quite adultery, right? And this also covers workplace or friendship relationships, moonlighting for a competitor in a business, cheating on a best friend, you know, that you thought was an exclusive relationship. Those kinds of things hurt trust. So violations of exclusivity. Third one, secrets, lies, or deceptions, naturally. If someone's telling you a lie or they're not being forthcoming, that breaks trust. Coalitions with others against you or against the partner, that's a violation of trust. Disinterest, lack of affection, that is also a violation of trust, feeling of being alone, and of course abuse and disrespect. So these are just some ways that trust can be broken. But he also observes that when trust is broken in one of these ways that we talk about, sometimes we'll say things like time heals all wounds. Time does not heal wounds. What people have to do is be intentional. They have to do intentional work to build back these 5 areas of trust. And what Gottman says here, I think, is so important for the Christian life. Forgiveness is an intentional act. It's not being absent-minded or not caring. Forgiveness is an intentional act. It's not simply forgetting. It's reforging a broken relationship. Now, some relationships need to be let go. And forgiveness in those cases is letting the other person go without wishing them harm. But if people want to maintain a relationship, they have to do specific things. Now, 2 of these things we've already talked about in previous sermons. One is what Gottman calls cherishing, not trashing. This is where when you have something that you want to complain to someone, you have a complaint, you want to change a specific behavior, you name 5 things that you appreciate about them before you ever get to your complaint. Again, I know that sounds cheesy, but I want to tell you, this changes situations entirely. So before you offer your complaint, you are such a good partner, such a good spouse. I love the way you do more than your share of the household chores. I appreciate that. You're a great parent to our kids. I thank you for changing the oil in the car last week. I really appreciate that. And I just love the way that you have courage to say things that need to be said. And then you offer your complaint. I would really like it if you would lock the door before you come to bed at night. Because otherwise I'm worried about someone breaking in, okay? So you offer a specific complaint. 5 things you appreciate, 1 complaint. Cherishing, not trashing. The other thing he talks about is gratefulness, not resentment. And part of that is that same thing. You're creating a culture of gratitude. Thank you. You thank people for what they do. We thank people all the time. And folks, I want to tell you, as I said, we're going to be talking about the DNA of our church. I want to be us a church that thanks people. I want us to thank people. Thank you for being greeters. Thank you, greeters, for doing your job and making people feel welcome when they come here. Thank you, people who set up the chairs every Sunday. Thanks for doing that. It's important. Thanks for people who make coffee. Thank you for the people who run in the tech sound. Thank you for people who are singing and providing music for us. We need to thank people profusely so that we can create a culture of gratitude. That way, not only does that stay in here in St. Junia, when we go out the wall, out of the walls here, we are creating a trust, a culture of trust in the wider society. Thank you for what you do. When you see a policeman stopping traffic, thank you for your service. Thanks for what you're doing. You thank people for providing your food. You tip them well. Oh boy, Christians, tip them well, please. You know, this is the stuff that we do to create trust, to really transform our culture. And it really does begin with us. It begins with the hard interpersonal work of changing our habits. Next time you want to complain to a coworker, if you have a situation you need to let a coworker know about and you want them to change, do the 5-to-1 thing. They will think you're crazy. You know, after you offer them 5 things that you appreciate about them, they'll be like, okay, what's coming? I'm totally blown away. You can change the culture of your workplace. You can change the culture of your school by implementing these practices. So that's about trust, y'all. I think God calls us to be trusting people, to trust God, to trust each other. And we can kind of ensure that that happens by implementing these things, by being people who don't run other people down behind their backs, who form alliances, who have other people's backs, who are accountable, who will accept responsibility for things and not try to pass the buck, who will demonstrate good ethics, who will be transparent in our lives. I think all those are ways that we can glorify God. And I think that's part of what Christ comes to do, so that we don't have to live in such a way that we walk on eggshells around each other. We can be loving and open and honest and not worry about judgment and shame and all that stuff. May we pray. Gracious God, we thank you so much for your love for us. We thank you for the way that you entrust your gospel to us flawed creatures. God, often we know we let you down, we let ourselves down. And yet, God, that's not what's important to you. It's the fact that we're learning and growing, that we're learning to trust and we are learning to be trustworthy. Help us to be more so that your gospel may be proclaimed to the ends of the earth and we may be your true disciples. Amen. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread, blessed it, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to God, then he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves as a living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. Make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Amen. I don't have my volunteer sheet up here, so I don't know. Did someone sign up to help with communion? Would someone like to help with communion who hasn't helped with it before? Come on, Travis. Cool. He just joined, and now he's going to serve. That's what I like to see. The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. If you'll take that. Come stand over here. This is not a Methodist table. This is the Lord's table. It's set for anyone who would like to receive. I'd like to ask the musicians come first so we can feed them and they can play for us. And then we'll do this section followed by that section. Just kind of come through and make a loop. Before we sing our last song, there are a few announcements, stuff going on. Our Easter service is going to be at Avondale Park on April 5th. That's a sunrise service. It starts at 7 in the morning, and I'm going to be preaching that service. It's a joint service between Beloved Community Church, Avondale United Methodist, and St. Junia, and anyone else in the Avondale community. We're also going to have a community choir, so I need to recruit people who like to sing early on a Sunday morning. So if you're cool with that, I would love for St. Junia to have a good showing. The other cool thing is there's people who are going to be in this community choir who probably don't go to any of those churches and who may not go to church at all, but who would love the opportunity to sing once a year with, you know, in a chorus, in a group of people. So your presence there is a witness to those people who will be coming in. So please, if you're at all interested in singing Sunday on April 5th, let me know. There will be a few practices at Avondale United Methodist Church. Their choir director is organizing it, so I think it's a couple of Wednesday nights before April 5th. So they'll also have the music out on SoundCloud if you want to listen to it and just practice your part. I'm so excited about this. I'm giddy. So if you can be part of this, please shoot me an email. I'm going to send out a newsletter this week, hopefully, that you can just reply to. I would love us to have a good showing at that. Also, we've got a cookout coming up on April 18th with Church of the Reconciler. This is their Housing Plus Cares program. And all you got to do, this is some great service, y'all. All you got to do is be there. Well, and bring some food. Be there, bring some food, play some games, because it's really, this is a social event. Because these are folks who've been on the streets. They are now in transitioning into housing, and to be part of a community of love and acceptance and just to be normal with folks is huge. If you've been through grinding poverty and are finally getting into a place where you can stand on your own feet, that just to socialize with these folks is a great, important experience. So there will be an opportunity for you to sign up to bring some food, to bring games. I mean, I'm asking you to come play cards with people. I mean, this is some good service, good mission stuff. Anne, anything else about that we need to let people know?
Oh yes,
because Anne's not going to be here. So usually Anne heads these up. So if you can head this up, if you've got some organizational skills, please let me know, because I don't. Anne would be the person to talk to, and she will let you know what you need to know. Okay. Other announcements, things we need to let people know? Yes, Gary? Oh, so, yeah, this morning I taught at Baptist Church of the Covenant, and they have it's a three-week series, so it'll be next Sunday. They start at 10:30. You can get there at 10, and they kind of mill around, and they drink coffee and stuff, and then 10:30 at Baptist Church of the Covenant. the class is full, but I'll write you a professor's note so that you can come attend if you would like to. So we had a great morning this morning talking with them, and the class that I'm teaching is on the Bible and homosexuality. I'm teaching my book next week, so if you would like to be part of that, let me know, and I'll write you a note. I'll just show up. Others? Other announcements? Then would you stand for our last song? Face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Have a great week.
If you'd like to learn more about St. Junia, you can do so by visiting stjunia.org. That's stjunia.org. And if you'd like to support us financially, I'd like to invite you to do that as well. You can do that at the link below. That's another way you can help join God in the renewal of all things and what God is doing through St. Junia United Methodist Church. Do feel free to join us anytime, 4:30 p.m., Sidebar Cafe in Birmingham, Alabama. Thanks. Have a great week. I hope you've enjoyed.